How are you?
I'm good, Edward. How are you doing? You're
on mute. Voice back at all good.
Well, it's good. Good. You're on mute. Just you can unmute.
Sorry about that. How are you, Steve?
I'm well, thank you. You doing well?
I am. Matter
Thanks
of fact.
Thanks for joining us.
Happy to be here.
Well, good, good. Well, one day I want to hear all about what you're doing and your portfolio of things. I know you've got a lot going on.
Seems like every day is swimming upstream.
More so now, huh?
Indeed.
So anyway, well, good. Well, thanks for joining us. We'll get started in just a sec. Just a sec. So I'm gotta go get a drink of water, and then I'll be right back. Okay, so I guess it's time to get the show on the road, and we have a real exciting group of real estate professionals on tap today to give us a brief review of the projects and what they're doing and how we can all be involved. We're pleased to be part of the Startup Club. I'm going to show a video in just a sec to give a little overview. But welcome everyone. We're pleased for everyone to join us, and let me see if I can get this teed up correctly to get going. First presenter got my notes here.
Okay, Olga, do you want to get started?
I'm still admitting some people to the room, but I think more participants are going to join us as we go along. So I think we can start now.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Great. Hi, I'm Richard Luftig from Castle Placement. Welcome to Capital 8. We're extremely excited for you to join us for this competition.
I'm sorry.
Placement, we absolutely love doing these competitions. We're doing this one.
I don't know what's
with the Startup Club, and we could not be more honored to work with such a.
Hold on, I'm terribly sorry. You just
gotta... the competition.
Steve, let me see if I can share my screen. Well, I'm going to share mine and we'll go to Caliber.
And then our judges will select the final four.
Steve, can you see my screen?
I can.
Followed by a 5-minute Q&A.
The problem is I'm not able to stop this.
Investment options. Caliber stands as a tangible, sophisticated real estate investment usually reserved for accredited investors in the areas of commercial, multifamily, self-storage, and hospitality. That concrete clarity and diversity within a high-level investment portfolio is now available to any new or existing Caliber investor.
Invigorating.
We're very focused on our investors. We do like to hear from the reason we invest, and we want to make sure that their experience is fantastic.
Caliber began as a small three-person business in 2008, purchasing distressed properties in the throes of the recession. The company began to grow and rack up accolades, adding additional projects and employees along the way. 70-plus employees now call Caliber home, and nearly 1,000 more through related activities and relationships. Caliber launched one of the first tax-advantaged Opportunity Zone funds in the nation and raised more than $14 million through three rounds of private funding. The company became profitable by 2019. The key to Caliber's success is our full-service real estate investment cycle, a series of separate business units that drive revenue. The cycle starts with you and your investment in Caliber. Investors gain exclusive access to off-market investment properties through the Caliber portal and expert sales team.
I've been an investor with Caliber for the last 7 years. I was just impressed with the job Caliber was doing. I've been a certified financial planner for 30 years. One of the things I really like about Caliber is how transparent they are about what's going on.
My investment prowess has been to find well-run, organized companies. The manager here is extremely talented.
The City University of New York,
Target acquisitions with our in-house procurement team, identifying projects and leverages resources and relationships that help shape the communities and constituencies we serve.
You know, I really appreciate Caliber's investment in downtown Mesa. There's a lot of adaptive reuse. It's really going to be perfect for the type of buildings that Caliber has and that it's marketing right now.
Through development and construction, we enhance value. The experienced Caliber development team evaluates and leverages cost benefits throughout process. The team mantra, doing what is best for the asset, allows
Wrap around the parking garage. You can park on each level. There's a lot more amenities. There's a pool. So it's a totally different class of product.
Gotcha. Thanks.
And what are the terms to the investor? You have a preferred return and how does that convert? Once the investor gets his capital back, his investment back.
Yeah, so we have a pari passu 9% preferred return, then a 70-30 split, 70% to the LP investors, 30% to the general partner, after return of capital and 9% preferred return.
Okay. And tell us a little bit about the portfolio you're trying to build and the company you're trying to become.
Sure. Well, we appreciate that question. And, you know, we have a pipeline of projects in the Dallas market. And as we mentioned in the presentation, we've now really focused to become more of a ground up multi-family development firm. So we have three projects in the pipeline in Houston as well. These are value add projects that are cash flowing. And so we've, you know, various projects all throughout Texas markets.
Okay.
Steve, this is Brian. I want to jump in with a question from our chat that just came in. Are you a vertically integrated firm, and do you handle all aspects, including lease up, et cetera?
We typically use third-party management on all of our properties, third-party construction. You know, we like to be a thin shop, so we typically source everything out.
Okay.
Great. Okay. Well, thank you.
Okay.
Steve,
well, thank you
ahead.
Very much. And as y'all pointed out, you've got information available to reach out to you to get more information, and we will be sending that to our participants as well to make sure they get it all. So thanks again for presenting.
Yeah, our pleasure. We'd be happy to hear from any of you. Thanks.
Okay, great. Thanks. All right, let's see. All right. Okay, let's see. The next presenter is going to be Water Lights on Lake Travis, and that's going to be Kristen Williams and her organization. So let me get them going. So
hi, everyone.
I'm sorry, guys.
Numerous other projects across the U.S. A quick thank you to the Startup Club for having us here today, and thank you to all of you for joining us today. My name's Kristen Williams, and I'm the president of Live Lab Communities. I'm very excited to be here today to tell you about our latest project, Water Lights. So Water Lights is a master plan community development in the city of Lago Vista, which is just outside of Austin, Texas. It has a fantastic location on the waterfront of Lake Travis, which is the premier lake recreation destination for all of Central Texas. When completed, Water Lights will comprise about 1,000 acres and have over 2,000 residential units, plus an active senior living community. In addition to residential, Water Lights will feature a 76-acre waterfront town center and a 30-acre area called HQX. This is a collection of flexible alternative workspaces that we like to think of as the Innovation Campus. Despite the economic slowdown, Austin is expected to surpass San Jose, California this year as the 10th largest city in the U.S. Specifically in North Austin, where Water Lights is located, the Census Bureau says that Round Rock and Cedar Park are the 7th and 13th fastest growing cities in the U.S. Redfin also cites that homebuyers' interest in small towns is soaring, far outpacing interest in big cities. Coronavirus has really emphasized the importance we place on our homes. People want comfort, outdoor elbow room, and the ability to somewhat homestead and feel self-sufficient, but they also need the technology available to be able to continue with work schedules, virtual schooling, and social interactions. Our team is fortunate because the community we've been planning addresses exactly those needs. We're working with Corning to provide full 5G fiber optic capabilities to the community. They see Water Lights almost as a test lab for their latest connectivity devices, and they've even mentioned the possibility of implementing next generation 10G networking. We have a partnership in place with Delos, who is leading the world in wellness initiatives to incorporate their Darwin system in every home. Darwin is a smart hub that optimizes light, water, and air quality inside the house. We're focused on sustainability through rainwater recapture, energy efficiency, and sustainable building practices. And we've been working with other partners to incorporate community-supported agriculture. The goal is for Water Lights to feel like a suburban homestead, but with a level of character and authenticity that often gets missed in large-scale master plan communities. Now, I've mentioned our relationships with Delos and Corning, and in addition, we've been refining our vision with input from people like Lake Flato, OJB, Marsh, and others. Many of you may know these names from projects like the Pearl Brewery development in San Antonio, Levy Park and Discovery Green in Houston, and numerous other projects across the U.S. And all of them have expressed excitement in being involved in a project with the potential of Water Lights. In addition to our strategic partners, the development itself is significantly progressed. Most of the entitlements are complete, and about a third of the acreage has water, sewer, electric, and fiber cabling to the curb. We have over 250 LUEs approved, 37 lots that are platted and shovel ready, plus approval for a waterfront condominium building with incredible views of the lake. There were few, if any, other large acreage parcels left on the main body of Lake Travis. As a development team, we felt like this gorgeous piece of land deserves something special, so we've tried very hard to come up with a unique offering for this unique property. We had a conversation a few months ago with a principal from RCL Co., and he told us, developers and production home builders aren't ready to branch out from these standard-looking master plan communities. They're still making plenty of money doing it, so why should they? But when I see something like this, it's refreshing and exciting, and I think there are a lot of people out there who really want this alternative. Moving on to our pro forma financial projections, for now, we've conservatively modeled this as a 10-year sellout. So for our 2,000 residential units, that's about 200 a year. The average home and average lot sales prices are $450,000 and $112,000 respectively, though there is a very wide range from starter garden homes to custom acreage lots. We also have 76 acres of commercial in our town center and 30 acres in the HQX Innovation Center. We conservatively assume that this sells for around $4 to $6 a square foot. We're also fortunate to have the benefit of some favorable debt terms. All of this culminates in an estimated $280 million of sales revenue. Against $150 million of development and construction costs, that's about $130 million net profit. Our team includes the landowner, who has invested significant equity in the project to date, so our incentives are properly aligned in making this project a success. Before I wrap up, I want to introduce our team. Again, I'm Kristen Williams, president of LiveLab Communities, and I've had about 15 years of experience in investment banking, corporate finance, and business development. Prior to Waterlights, I spent the majority of my career working at companies such as Credit Suisse, the Blackstone Group, and the AES Corporation. David Goswick is my director of marketing, and his career in real estate and marketing spans over 35 years. He's represented some of the largest names in residential development, including Royal Oaks in Houston, Cordillera Ranch in San Antonio, and Ryland Homes. Our director of operations is Kelly Dyer, who is also an industry veteran, and he has over 30 years of leadership experience with builders such as Pulte Homes, the Hovnanian Companies, and Ryland Homes. Our team is rounded out by William Farrell, general counsel, Gary Cobb, our real estate director, and Brian Atlas, landowner and developer, who all have 20 to 40 years in the real estate industry and in business development. Together, the LiveLab team is excited to present to you the Waterlights development, and we look forward to its continued progress and any inquiries you may have. Thanks again, and stay well.
Okay, thank you so much, Kristen. All right, do we have any questions? John, Brian?
Hi, Kristen. This is John Bianco. Is this current development, is there a taxing authority like a MUD or a TERS or any kind of, or is it in a city?
So this is within the city of Lago Vista. There's one piece of the parcel that's in the ETJ, the extraterritorial jurisdiction right outside of Lago Vista. We are currently working with an attorney to file a TERS. So yes, there will be a taxing authority involved.
Okay, excellent. And second question, you said how many, there's certain number of single family home lots already available for construction and what kind of, so roads and water and sewer have already been implemented and what percentage of the project?
So this is going to be a roll up of about four different parcels of varying size. So one of these has been significantly more developed than the other and that represents about 350 acres of the total. That 350 acres has pretty much all infrastructure in place, including fiber optic cabling to at least the curb of every lot. 37 of those lots are shovel ready today and really could be sold off today. And we have 262 approved living unit equivalents for that area. And so as we continue development, that will obviously increase up to the total number of 2,000, but that's what we have available today.
Great, thank you.
Okay, and what's your, what kind of development competition do you have in that area of Lake Travis or any other lake communities in that area?
Yeah, so it's obviously a very popular area for Austin. Lake Travis is one of the most popular lake destinations in all of Texas. The good thing about it is that there are, at this point, very few large acreage lots that are left available. So as far as lakefront area of this size, it's, I do not think that there's anything of this magnitude and size that's not already developed and in place. We see our pre-developed competition as Treviso, which is a highly successful but not waterfront community, as well as the Hollows, which is also highly successful, but it's been in place for quite a while and does not have the same types of amenities that we would be offering. We think that this is a pretty unique opportunity to be on the main body of Lake Travis, because anything else at this point is going to be much farther up the lake and farther from what people call the main area of Lake Travis.
Okay, very good. Thank you. I'm sorry. I can't seem to find the mute button but would everybody please mute their microphone when they're not speaking. Thank you very much. Okay, well, what other developers are going to participate in the home building and the commercial development from the ground up?
So we have been in contact with one very large commercial developer who has expressed an interest in doing the town center development. As far as on the residential side, we have home building capabilities internally. So we think that approximately half of the homes are going to be built by our captive construction company. Mm-hmm. And in addition to that, we're going to be partnering with one other large home builder based out of the Houston area, who is also very interested in participating in the development.
Okay. And you say it's a 10-year development plan. When do y'all anticipate building the first living unit?
That is planned within the next 6 months. So we intend to kick off very soon. And, I think the total development time we estimate to be about 10 years, but that's really quite a conservative estimate for the real estate market in Austin. Sure. So we think it could be much sooner than that.
Okay. Well, very good. And how can anyone that has an interest in knowing more find out more about your development and your project?
We have a website at www.waterlights.org, and that has all of our contact information there.
Okay, well, very good. Well, thanks so much. Do you care to kind of recognize any other contributors or architectural firms or development firms that have been a part of this?
Sure. As I mentioned on the presentation, we've primarily been working with Lake Plato, who is going to be our master architect for the community, as well as OJB, who is a very well-known landscape architectural firm nationally and particularly in Texas. We have Corning on board to work on the fiber optic capabilities, and also Delos, who we have a partnership agreement in place to certify this really as the first master plan community. The first wellness certified master plan community in the world. So those are our primary partners. We have a couple others that we're working with, but those are still moving around a little bit, but we have a very nice strategic partnership team in place as it is.
Okay, well, great. Well, thank you so much, Kristen. And we will be sure and get the information out to all the participants and others, and thanks for being on our program.
Thank you.
Okay, the next on our program is Brian Daly of the San Antonio Home Builders, Inc. Brian, if you would be kind enough to put your deck on share and then give us your thoughts on your project and how we can participate.
Thank you. I sent a video. Did you not get that?
The video?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, why don't we jump to Kesey, and then we will, Brian and I will find that. We thought that it was a deck rather than a video, so our mistake. Why don't we jump to Ken Bloskus and his son Grayson on Kesey. Brian, let's see if we can find that video and then circle back. So thank you very much. Ken, are you ready to go? You can unmute if you're muted. Grayson? Okay, we'll need to track them down. Matt, Fresh Capital Fund.
What's going on?
Hold on. Yeah, how you doing? Hold on, let me. Ken? Are y'all on board? Okay. I think you need to log on right now. Do you have the link? Okay. Log on right now, and we're actually on it right now. So once you jump on. Yeah. So jump on. Sorry about the confusion.
Brian, this is Brian Emerson. I did see where I got a copy of your video, but it said access denied. So if you could either open that up for me, or if you want to just play it on your machine, whatever's easier for you at that time, what would you like to do?
I could just play it.
Okay, great. Sure, no problem. That's great. Okay, well, I'll tell Steve that, all you'll need to do is hit share your screen, play it, and then we'll all be able to hear it and see it. So, Steve, as you heard, Brian's just going to play the video on his machine when you're ready for him.
Okay, I'm ready.
Oh, get going. All right. so let's do this. Okay. Okay. Well, while I'm doing this, just again, I wanted to preface by saying thank you. Like the rest of them, I'm not as big as some of the others, but, I'm still excited to be here. So I think I got it. Here you go.
Right.
My name is Brian Daly. I am the founder of the San Diego Home Buyer, and we are on a mission to bring life and value back to distressed homes and communities all over San Diego County. And I'm here to present you an opportunity today to potentially join us on that mission. I'm calling it short-term flips for long-term profits. So let's get into it. I want to start off quickly by showing some photos since they tell a story in a lot less words. This is an example of a kitchen remodel we did on a home in Chula Vista, California, which is South County, San Diego. We spent $53,000 on this project. It took us 50 days to complete. It took us another 26 days to sell it for a total hold time of 76 days, and we made a profit of $85,000 on this project. This is another example of probably one of my favorite properties that to date that I've been a part of. I love the transformation. This is obviously the example of the exterior transformation we did, which extended throughout the interior of the property as well. This project took us 68 days. It was a $125,000 remodel. And we are currently on the market under contract to sell it at $810,000, which is $85,000 over our expected sales price of $725,000. So super excited about that. And so I want to start by getting into a little more detail about why I'm bullish on San Diego specifically. Since the end of the Great Recession, we have not been building units here in San Diego, not enough at least. We are 59,000 below where we should be just to meet the population growth we've had in that time. In post-COVID-19, homes with exterior space, detached homes, are in higher demand now more than ever. And those are the hardest for developers to build. It's just too cost prohibitive in California. So basically, we feel like we're satisfying this demand for new homes without the cost or the long-term hold risk that usually goes in with building new home construction. In addition to that, you know, why now? We live in an HGTV inspired world. We also live in an Amazon inspired world where people just want to press the easy button and have things done. So buyers want updated homes, but they don't have the cash or the experience to pull it off. And when they buy a property from us, they don't have to deal with all of the headache that goes with doing the construction themselves. And they also get a finance. They don't have to come up with the cash. They get to finance it with low interest, tax deductible interest. And it just allows us to sell our homes at a premium. Not to mention now in our post-COVID-19 world, our homes are vacant. They're staged. They feel like they're brand new. They feel like no one's ever lived in them before. You know, that's just easier for buyers to show, easier for buyers to fall in love with. And we're getting a premium for our properties now, even bigger than before, because we're competing with sellers that still live in their house, and buyers, it just makes it so much more difficult for buyers to see it. Hold times are short and getting even shorter. This is specifically related to the marketing time when we're going to sell the properties. The average marketing time was 45 days in January 2019, which is already super, super fast. But that's down to 30 days in May, and it's still trending lower as we speak. So again, the demand from buyers just exceeds supply by so much that now is just a great time to be in this position in San Diego. So San Diego's great, Tommy's great, so why us? Well, the teams that I've overseen and managed have purchased, renovated, and sold over 371 properties.
Uh-oh. Don't know what happened, hold on.
So we save,
Sorry about that, guys. Thank you. Let's try again.
San Diego. So, San Diego's great. Tommy's great. So why us? Well, the teams that I've overseen and managed have purchased, renovated, and sold over 371 properties here in Southern California. We have now in-house construction, so we save over 20% on retail construction costs. Again, we've been doing this for a long time, and I am obsessive about my reputation and integrity in the market. Our company has a top-notch reputation, which attracts a lot of off-market opportunities that most people don't have an opportunity to even purchase. And, you know, we chose the name and domain on purpose. We have a strong brand and marketing presence, which we barely started to tap, which brings us a lot more off-market opportunities. And there are so many more opportunities to expand on that direct-to-seller marketing, which, again, we just haven't even started to tap yet. So why? So let's get a little bit into more about me and the team. I've been in real estate since 2005. I was an asset manager for JP Morgan Chase for a few years during that time. Throughout the process since 2005, I've bought, managed, and or sold over 2,000 properties or 2,000 units across 20 states, including, syndicated 5 apartment buildings, upwards of 700 units for those buildings. I'm also, not to my own horn, but experienced in business, brand, and team building. In my career, I did take 2 years of hiatus to go work with a gentleman by the name of Darren Hardy, who, if you don't know, I recommend looking into. He's a brilliant, brilliant business mind and a brilliant personal development success mentor. Anyway, that experience felt like Navy SEALs of business building. And I've been able to take all the experience that I've got from him and from that experience to this new endeavor. And it is really paying off. I also publish a weekly newsletter in San Diego. Since we are such a fast-paced team and environment, I keep track of the weekly stats and the market movements on a weekly basis. And that's also helped our brand reputation here in the San Diego market. But it's not about me at all. This is a team sport. And the best team wins, and we have for sure the top-notch squad. Real quick, Christian Chavez is our director of construction. He has 10 years experience in construction management, almost all of which is in value-add renovations. So he has 500 of these renovations under his belt. He previously managed the construction for a $25 million fund in Southern California, where they were buying and selling over 30 properties a month, which is a lot bigger than what we're doing right now. Gary has 20 years experience in San Diego real estate, where he's managed the sale of over 700 renovated properties. JC, our VP of operations, has 15 years experience in real estate and business operations. He's most recently was responsible for the management of the construction of an international resort development, portfolio, which was valued over $750 million. And then we got Mike Litton, our director of acquisitions. He's been in real estate for 28 years, 14 of which he was the broker, owner, and operator of a Keller Williams office in Escondido, which is North County, San Diego. He managed over 100 real estate agents, and he is, again, well-respected in the San Diego real estate market. And then Neva Ellis is my right hand. She's been with me since 2012 in all of my real estate value-add endeavors. So they are just a great squad. Real quick, just a typical project. Purchase price, $45,000. These are based on averages that we've done basically in 2019. $65,000 in repairs. Our average hold time is 120 days and getting shorter. Average equity investment per property is $120,000 for a net profit. After the sale at $600,000 for net profit. $65,000 in repairs. Our average hold time is 120 days and getting shorter. Average equity investment per property is $120,000 for a net profit. After the sale at $600,000 for a net profit of $38,712. Again, just an example of a typical project. And that net profit removes all the financing costs, which is, we usually finance it anywhere between 70 to 90% of the cost, the purchase price plus the repairs. And that's probably getting a little too detailed, but the opportunity, I've been doing this for a while, and we've been raising money on a one-off basis per project or using our own funds to do it, and we're just looking to grow up a little bit. So the opportunity here is we're starting a real estate growth fund with a $5 million targeted raise, which is a 7% preferred return to our investors. We plan to operate for 3 years, and we're targeting an IRR between 14 and 16%. And again, as I mentioned before, we're on a mission. This is what we're passionate about. We love it. We love the transformations we get to do. We're on a mission to bring life and value back to distressed homes and communities all over San Diego. And just wondering if you want to join us. Here's one last example, just because I love what we do. done on. I thought this is a cool transformation of a typical detached home, starter home that we're focusing on here in San Diego. So for more information, I'd love to talk to you. Again, my name is Brian Daly. I'm founder of San Diego Homebuyer, and my direct cell phone number is 619-888-4376. I am grateful and honored to have the time to present to you today. Thank you for listening, and I am looking forward to speaking to you. All righty. Put everyone to sleep.
Okay. Yeah, go ahead, Brian, if you would give us a couple more comments as questions are coming in.
Recap for us.
I've been in this space in San Diego since 2011, really doing the value added investments in single family, also small multifamily here locally. This is my second go around of building a team and starting a company and raising money for the same kind of niche. I did a company from 2011 to 2016 and exited it at the end of 2016, took a hiatus and came back.
Okay. How's the housing market affected by the virus there? Is it a stronger demand for rental properties?
Honestly, the resale market of existing homes is on fire. I mean, what we've seen is because we have a lack of available inventory, both on rentals and for sale. We just have a lot of people that have been stuck in their homes for 2 months, 3 months that really decided they hate it. And so we have more demand now on the buyer side than ever, at least over the last year or two. But we have a lot less inventory. Right now specifically, we're experiencing rapid appreciation, which is temporary. Of all the niches and industries out there, the resale San Diego, single family market is actually benefiting from this whole COVID situation.
Okay. Is your portfolio all single family detached, or are you going to have some multifamily? Or
90% of it is single family, is detached. We're a value add play. We get anything residential. We every once in a while we'll get townhomes and condos. We're just a lot less bullish on those. We have a 7-unit building in San Diego right now, kind of the heart of it, which we'll dabble in as the opportunities come. But our main focus is that starter home, sub 800, which is crazy, I know, for a lot of people in different markets, but the starter home to the second homeowner, second home buy is, sub 800 price point is where, detached homes, where we do 90% of our buys.
Okay. Yeah. Is this investment open to anyone other than accredited investors?
No. Good question. Thank you. It will be just to accredited investors. We are finalizing the PPM and putting together subscription packages, so that'll be ready in a couple of weeks. But yes, it is only accredited investors.
Okay. And you were with JP Morgan as an asset manager of these type assets. Where did that? What were some of the experiences you had with them?
Well, they were distressed assets. So it was from, it was in the heyday. I joined the dark side in 2008 until 2012, basically. So they were, again, it's where I cut my teeth in this distressed single family space. They were primarily single family homes. That was over about 15 states, managing about 300 assets at a time and just doing the, remotely the renovation and sale of those properties.
Okay. All right. Okay. Anyone else with a question?
Hey, Brian, what's the investment proposition and distribution and do
yeah.
you work off a credit line from the debt side or use just
so we
asset
work
back loans on a portfolio basis or on a per project basis?
Good question. On the debt side, we raise it's a very, very seamless, fast process, but they do a trust deed on every property. It takes, you know, 5 to 10 days max to put it together. And so that's done individually. The investment proposition here is a pool to handle the equity. And basically our plan is to turn that equity over multiple times a year as we come across these properties. You know, as I mentioned there, our hold time is 120 days and getting shorter. So we, you know, we just monitor the market very, very closely and make shifts as we go. And whether it's going up or down, the strategy works. It's just, you just got to buy right.
So as an equity investor, do you expect a annual payment or option to roll over, or you call feature that you 120-day call, or so, how does that work?
So we expect quarterly, basically dividend-like payments for the preferred rate of return, and then the rest of the money will be held into that fund, and the fund assets will grow over the 3-year operating period, and we'll use those to buy more and more assets. At the end of the 3-year period, we will disperse. We have a I guess a hurdle rate at 16, you know, the investor earns 70%, our LP earns 70% of the profit up to a 16% IRR. And after 16% IRR, it shifts to a 40-60, 40 to the investor, 60 to the GP.
Gotcha.
So we're very highly incentivized to
sure.
Blow expectations out of the water.
All right. Thanks.
Yep.
Okay, well, thank you very much. Do you want to give everyone your contact information so they can reach out to you?
Yeah,
absolutely. Sending it, but please share it.
Absolutely, yeah. Related to the investment, reach out to me directly. My cell phone number again is 619-888-4376. My email is Brian with an I, B-R-I-A-N at the THESanDiegoHomeBuyer.com. And we have a one pager that has a little bit more information to take away. And as I said, we'll have the subscription packets in a couple weeks.
Super. Thanks so
Thank you so much.
Brian, this is Brian Emerson again. I see we've got a couple more questions that have come in by chat, but I know since our time's up, we'll get those to you here afterwards and make sure we get the answers back to those who posted them. So thank you so much.
Yeah, no problem. Absolutely. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, now Matt Bodner. Matt is with Fresh Capital Fund, and they are acquiring commercial assets with a focus on medical facilities, medical office buildings and such. Matt, are you ready to go?
I am, yeah. Let me share my video now.
Great, thank you.
Hey, everyone. I wanted to thank you, first of all, for attending this great event, and especially thank Stephen and the Starlight team for putting it together. We're Fresh Capital, and this is our Medical Real Estate Income Fund. We're launching a fund to acquire income-producing medical real estate. The fund's investment objectives are to deliver 10% plus annualized passive cash-on-cash returns to our investors over a 7 to 10-year time horizon by acquiring and holding strong medical real estate assets. We have a direct relationship with the primary developer for an aggressively expanding, private equity-backed, and soon-to-be publicly traded urgent care and surgery center operator. Our direct relationship with the developer gives us attractive off-market pricing for acquired properties, which improves our portfolio returns. And by buying these properties directly from the developer, we further reduce transaction costs and provide a pipeline of brand new assets with full new lease terms, which increases returns further. We have an existing acquisition pipeline of 17 properties already under construction or under contract, representing approximately $150 million in gross asset value. This is comprised of 9 urgent care facilities and 8 surgery centers. We're seeking institutional investors to provide equity capital for the fund. Some high-level fund metrics. The average cash-on-cash return for the fund is over 10%. The IRR is over 15%. We're targeting a 7 to 10 year hold. The portfolio mix is 17 properties across 5 states. That's 9 urgent care facilities and 8 surgery center facilities. A cap rate for a comparable property that we're acquiring would be between 5.95% and 6.3%. Our fund is acquiring these at between 6.5 and a 7 cap. The reason that we're able to acquire these below market, as I said previously, is because we have a direct relationship with the developer and we're able to negotiate without brokers in the middle, which further reduces the transaction costs and enables us to purchase these at very attractive valuations. And by pre-purchasing these from the developer and negotiating the relationship in advance, we're able to get even better price concessions, which enables us to buy these properties at below market values, immediately accreting value to the fund when we close the purchase. The price range for the properties, the urgent care facilities themselves will be between 4.25 and 4.5 million. And the surgery centers will be between 11.5 and 13.3 million. And that's per property. The total capital structure for the fund will be about $150 million. And that will be roughly $50 million in equity and $100 million in debt. What makes Fresh Capital unique? We're a vertically integrated commercial real estate investment, development, and property management firm. As owners of hundreds of properties across the country, we know exactly how to source and execute real estate transactions that can truly create value. Our asset management team and our property management team are both in-house and have decades of experience managing assets across the country. By keeping both of these functions in-house, we're able to maintain a direct hands-on approach throughout the investment life cycle. Fresh Capital uses our extensive network and our deep industry experience to identify attractive opportunities across the real estate value spectrum. Here's our portfolio at a glance. We currently have over $350 million in projects executed, over 100 properties managed and developed, and over 1 million square feet in total gross assets developed. Properties are across the board from single tenant to retail to medical office, shopping centers, mixed use, public-private partnerships, and much more. Here's a brief look at our team. These are our 3 core partners. That's me there in the center. My background, to give you a very short summary, I worked in investment banking at Goldman Sachs for a number of years after graduating from college up in New York, and then I moved back home to Nashville, where I'm originally from, and joined my family office. My family office has a deep background in real estate investing and commercial real estate development. After spending a number of years there, I co-founded Fresh Capital with my business partner, Matt Birch, who has a master's in accounting and is a deep transaction expert in the real estate world. And we've been doing this since 2012. So we've been doing it for almost 10 years, and we have a portfolio of more than $350 million in assets. To give you a brief look at the urgent care market, according to the CDC, ER visits are increasing at record levels, but the actual availability of ER rooms are shrinking. Over 70% of emergency room visits are unnecessary and could be handled in an urgent care setting. A 2016 study found that ER visits on average cost 10x what an urgent care visit costs. And according to the US Bureau of Labor and Statistics, healthcare jobs were projected to grow by nearly 20% from 2014 to 2024, which means there's a very robust labor force. Urgent cares, in a nutshell, reduce the strain on emergency rooms, they unclog waiting rooms, and they get people out of hospitals and into outpatient medical care facilities that are outside of the core hospital ecosystem. Even in the context of something like COVID, this is a huge benefit because people don't want to be going into hospitals where all the sick and infected people are. You want to be able to go somewhere that isn't as busy, that doesn't have as many people, and you can get treated for something without having to put yourself and your family at risk. The surgery center market, in a similar vein, is thriving. Bain Consulting notes that ambulatory surgery centers are transforming healthcare by moving routine low-risk procedures into a more convenient setting. ambulatory surgery centers offer surgical procedures at rates between 35% and 50% lower than hospitals offer them, which is a $40 billion savings a year to the healthcare industry, and it improves patient care and quality while reducing healthcare costs. In addition to that, certificates of need create an artificially suppressed availability of surgery centers, which improves the economics of these businesses and means that there's only a select number that can go into any given market. The tenant themselves, there's a very strong tenant that stands behind these assets. They're private equity backed, well capitalized, and they have a robust balance sheet with nearly $100 million in cash sitting behind the leases with a corporate guarantee. They're also in the final stages of completing a public securities listing, and they will soon be publicly traded. The tenant is a vertically integrated healthcare provider that bridges the gap between urgent care and the traditional hospital system with their proprietary operating model. And by doing that, they're able to generate substantially higher unit level economics than a traditional urgent care or surgery center. Given the complexities and the confidentiality with their public securities listing, we can provide a tremendously larger amount of information after the execution of an NDA. The lease overview, the leases commence at close of escrow. They're 20-year leases. There's a 20-year term remaining because these will all be brand new leases as of the close of the transaction. There's 2% annual bumps in all of the lease rates. The tenant has 3 5-year options in addition to the original 20-year term. These are absolute net leases. These are even better than triple net. The tenant is responsible for everything, including roof and structure. And there's a strong corporate balance sheet standing as a guarantee behind every single lease. So let's summarize this opportunity. We're raising a $150 million fund to acquire stabilized income-producing medical real estate, specifically to acquire 17 properties, 9 urgent care centers, and 8 surgery centers in Tennessee, Georgia, Alabama, Arkansas, and Texas. We fully identified the acquisition pipeline. This is not a blind fund. We have the 17 properties that we're going to acquire, and they're currently either being built or under LOI, all of which we can acquire once the fund is funded. We have attractive below-market acquisition pricing. Our direct relationship with the developer enables us to acquire these properties off-market and with substantial discounts to the current market price for comparable assets. Both of these asset classes, urgent care and surgery centers, are in well-positioned, both in the current COVID economic environment and have very strong positive macro trends supporting them over the long term. We have a compelling tenant that's well-capitalized, aggressively expanding, and soon to be publicly listed. We have secure leases with a corporate guarantee, 20-year term that's brand new, 2% annual bumps, and they're absolute net, so the tenant is responsible for all costs. The focus on this investment portfolio is to drive passive, absolute net cash-on-cash returns for our investors, and we're targeting over a 10% cash-on-cash return for our LPs. If you want to contact us, this is my direct personal contact information. Again, my name is Matt Bodner. You can reach me at 615-289-3992 or email me matt@bodnergroup.com. You can also check out our website, freshcapitalgroup.com. With that, I open the floor to questions.
Well, thank you, Matt. And do we have any questions? I've got a question on how you selected the medical field. As the medical industry is one where you felt like these properties would be a good portfolio. See where the cap rates on the acquisition are on the low side. Why do you think that's the right play in the real estate sector to be?
Yeah, absolutely. So the question is, what, you know, why did we select the medical field and how do the cap rates kind of relate to the broader real estate industry as a whole? I would say we selected medical for a couple reasons. One, there's a lot of really positive macro trends that support medical real estate as a whole. Two, it's Amazon proof in the sense of, you know, if you look at a lot of real estate assets, they can be harmed or jeopardized by e-commerce and things like that. Medical really can't be. And so, you know, we think that that's a really compelling piece of it. And really the third piece is, You know, we really believe in this tenant. They have a differentiated operating model that we think really makes them very compelling from a long-term perspective, and feel like that can really drive meaningful returns across the portfolio. But really, if you look at the cap rates on the assets we're acquiring, the market comps are actually lower cap rates than the acquisition price that we're buying these assets. So comparable assets trade in kind of the low, like high five, low six cap range for surgery centers and urgent care facilities. And we're buying them because we have a direct relationship with the developer, because we have essentially a pre-purchase agreement with them. We're buying the assets as soon as they're finished being built. And because of the fact that we're not paying any brokers or anything like that, we're able to really negotiate very attractive acquisition caps that we otherwise wouldn't be able to find on the open market. And so our acquisition cap rates are actually between 50 and 100 basis points higher, i.e. cheaper than a typical comparable asset would be valued at. That makes sense.
Yeah. So you're just acquiring the assets, not the businesses.
That's right. Yeah, this is purely a real estate play, absolute net leases hold long-term for passive cash flow.
Would you ever consider becoming an REIT?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I would say that this is almost essentially a small private REIT, or a step towards moving towards a private REIT.
Right. Okay. All right. How did you select your five states geographically?
Combination of those are the states that the tenant wants to be expanding in, plus the fact that on the urgent care side, we've selected a number of states that don't have certificate of need, just because that enables us to expand more aggressively. And on the surgery center side, it's really opportunistic in terms of locating where the surgery centers are, and in terms of the business model is essentially almost redeveloping existing surgery centers, adding additional features and facilities, and then leasing them to the tenant. And so on the surgery center side, it's really opportunistic, basically finding surgery centers, because that market is constrained by certificates of need. There's not a lot of supply really available. And so we've been really fortunate to find essentially a source of additional supply of surgery centers that we can acquire into the portfolio. And the other component too, I mean, we're based in Nashville. A lot of the portfolio states within the portfolio have very favorable tax treatment. So Tennessee, Texas, et cetera. So that was a component as well.
Yeah. Okay. Well, very good. Any other questions, Brian? Did you have any that came in on the chat? Okay. Well, very good. Well, thanks so much.
I'm sorry about that. I was on mute there a second. No, Matt, it sounds really exciting. I think you've picked a really laser-focused niche. Your background's perfect for this. So look forward to helping you get the word out about it. So thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Okay. Thanks so much, Matt. All right. Let's see. We have Kesey is a fund out of Dallas, and due to a mix up, they're not going to be joining us. But I wanted to introduce them. They'll be our next show is going to be August the 4th. But I wanted to make you aware, and we will send around this information to all the participants. They are specializing in acquiring single-family detached properties for lease, taking advantage of the spike in lease demand. And so I'm not going to go through the entire presentation, but they're raising a $50 million fund to make these acquisitions. And it'll be essentially a five-year fund. And so we'll be sending this around to everyone for their review. And then we can have some one-on-ones for those that are interested. Brian, any comments to wrap it up?
Um,
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, I thought I was on mute again. Running for the mute button, that's always our problem. No, I guess the only other thought is let's talk about the survey. We've got the survey we would love everybody to fill out if they would like. I'm sending it out right now in the chat, so you can click on that to give us a little feedback and let us know which of the companies you'd like more information on. The other thing is that, Steve, I think you want to talk about a couple gifts that we want to give out. Want to explain that?
Yeah, for those that take a minute and fill out the survey and return it, we will select one and send out a gift certificate based on you know, a random selection from the returned surveys. And secondly, we wanted to take nominations for those that might be joining us from the furthest distance from Texas. So if you feel like that you are a person from far away, then we've got a gift certificate for you. The last one was from Australia, which is hard to beat. I think that's something like 7,500 miles. I think our German participants are at 5,000 miles, give or take. So, if you feel like you're the furthest away, send us a chat, and we will select the person that joins us from the furthest point, and that'll be a gift certificate as well. So.
And also, as a reminder to everybody, please check the chats now. I see there's been a stream of good comments and conversations started in the chat room. So take a look at those before you go, and feel free to respond to anyone. I know some people want to share their LinkedIn address or other contact information. You're welcome to do that in the chat while we've got it up for everyone. And otherwise, we'll do some of our sharing of information after the conference, you know, directly.
Okay, thank you, Brian.
Steve, do you want to also mention the next couple conferences coming up that you're hosting?
Yes, we've got, we're going to have a focus on opportunity zones on August the 5th. That's a Wednesday, August the 5th. And we'll also combine real estate opportunities with that. We'll have to, we'll move Keezy and their fund to that date, give everyone an opportunity to meet them. And there were several others that wanted to participate but couldn't get their videos together in time. So we're looking forward to some exciting projects and real estate. And then following that, August 27th, we will have a technology conference, and that technology conference will be international. We've got some very exciting technologies to share. We've got one that's out of Israel that is a technology that embeds a chemical compound in materials and materials for gowns and masks and for that matter seat covers that kills bacteria and virus because of the chemical that's embedded in the material. So that's very exciting. So August the 27th. And
can I just mention, Stephen,
please,
that on August the 28th we're having in London the Capital Mayhem event, which is going to be a cash prize to the best pitch.
Oh, good, good. Yes, this is the second Capital Madness conference they're having. It's, so thank you for
Mayhem.
That.
Capital
yes.
Mayhem.
Capital Mayhem, okay, very good. Thank you for mentioning that, and everybody set your calendars, and please give us your feedback. We want to keep you on our list. Brian has a membership campaign going on, so we are adding members to our international group of entrepreneurs and investors. And we're very excited about our outreach and our efforts to find support for our entrepreneurs everywhere. So please be a part of it. So Brian, you want to say goodbye? I'll leave that.
Well, yeah, that's all we've got today. So thank you again, everyone, for coming. Again, check the chat messages, and we'll look forward to seeing you again soon. Thanks for joining us.
Thank
Have
you
a
very
good
much.
Rest of your day or evening. Bye-bye.
Sam, homing reality. Are we staying on the chat? Stephen, yeah, we're staying on the chat because somebody's just messaged me, actually.
Oh, we are.
Hello, Tarak.
Yes,
are you still online? Yeah, hi. Yeah. I was looking for the website for that.
The website is startupclub.biz, and the event is not live at the moment, but I've got your email, so I'm going to make it either today or tomorrow live, and then I'll send you the link for it.
Okay, so you don't have it to post right now so everybody can see it?
No, I haven't. Because there's plenty of time yet. It's in August. We've got 8 weeks as it is. Okay. And we'll be promoting it and marketing it and so forth as you do. I just wanted to take this opportunity to mention it to people.
Very good. Very good. Well, heads up is a smart way to go.
Yeah.
All right. Good job.
What's your business, Ken?
Well, as you can tell by the by the email that I use for my name, it's
Finance Options.
And we are in the business of knowing where the money is and how to get it.
Oh, I see. Listen, I've got one project. It's an alternative to YouTube. Okay.
Oh, good.
They're already live, and they're looking for $3.5 million.
Very good. Sounds like a very good number.
Would you be interested if I sent you the pitch deck?
Oh, yes. Please do that. Yeah, I'll get the email there.
Okay, I'll do that later on. I've made a written note of it as well.
Yeah, please send. You know, we're heavy in the real estate, technology, combinations of the two, and anything that's sort of on the periphery of that.
Well, there is another project, which is my own, which is my background is in the entertainment industry. And that particular project is about starting an online bank for filmmakers.
Ooh. Very good. I like the online bank idea. Since we work with banks all the time.
Oh, really?
Okay. Always looking for great sources. And I'll tell you, the key that I've found is you know, it's not quite like startups. Startups I find that are, you know, kind of back into their business most of the time. Not these guys, of course, but the many other businesses. But, you know, lenders are not terribly different. You know, they say, hey, you know, I'd like referrals. I said, okay, we send your referral agreement. Oh, we don't have one. Well, why not? You know, hasn't anybody asked you for a referral agreement before? And so you would think that they'd already have their legal beagles looking over their referral agreement so that they make sure that, you know, there's no holes in it and it can stand up in court on both sides. So it's just amazing the number of lenders that I've spoken to that just really are not ready to work with outside intermediaries, no matter how talented they are.
Well, that's on both sides. Yeah. I mean, the majority of the people in the finance industry now are in their 60s and 70s, and they're used to working a particular kind of way. It's only the young ones in the 30s and 40s who are more open to that.
True. Well, you would think that the people that are of pushing senior status would have already figured out that, you know, documentation beats conversation every day. So the idea
is they've made
it's good to write it down, get it written on, get it signed off, you know, and then say, okay, now there's no questions.
They've made their money and they're sitting it out until retirement.
Yeah. Okay. So they have people call, they just, you know, they fill out the forms, they submit them, and, you know, sometimes people get money. That's what you're saying?
That's true.
Okay.
Is there anyone else who wants to come into this conversation? I've got John Bianco, Brian Daly, Natalie, Oliver.
Yeah.
Oliver, do you want to come in? And Kelly Dyer.
We're losing our audience here for some reason. Yeah. The other aspect of what I'm finding is
unmute yourself.
Hey, Brian, how you doing?
Hi.
Good presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I feel a little small.
Now going a double step there by you putting it on your chat screen. The audio wasn't as well as it could be, but you know, you can solve that by sending the video out to people like me who are asked for it.
Cool. Right? I will.
Yeah.
I will.
Yeah. You were going to say something.
I was just making banter. I was just commenting on some of the exciting projects people got going on. They're a lot larger than what we have going on here in San Diego. So it's exciting to see.
Yes. They're good. So I'm real anxious to see your proposals. Go ahead.
What is your what was your project or is your project, Brian?
It's more of a pool of multiple projects. I'm out of San Diego, and I do and I have been since 2012. I value add investments in the residential and small multifamily space. So,
what do you mean by value add?
Well, yeah, simple model. We buy distressed properties for as low as we can get them. And through construction, primarily through construction, we add the value and then sell them. Short term, most of them under 4 or 5 months.
It's a very well-organized fix and flip organization. Is that exactly?
That's what I was going to say.
All version?
Yeah, simplified, right?
High professional, very well organized flip and flip, fix and flip organization, which, you know, to tell you the truth, the people that try to do that onesie twosies on their own, you know, they'd run into all kinds of problems, like, you know, like some lazy appraiser who doesn't appraise it for what it's really worth, and they wind up losing money. You do that a couple of times and they're out of dough. I've heard that over and over and over and over again. And, you know, just say I ran out of money because I couldn't get enough money out of my project.
It can be a trap too. I mean, it's a lot of work.
In 2005, I bought two properties and attempted to fix them up. And one became a money pit because everything that we broke into was just absolute garbage. You know, we had the ceiling hanging with baling wire, basically, and the brick walls were not brick walls. They were walls with brick in them. I mean, it's just crazy stuff like that. We were lied to and lied to. It would have been a really nice project, except for the fact that it was just so full of garbage. And then we pulled, you know, one wall off. It looked like it had been burnt. So, you know, from a single small little guy, it just became a huge money pit. We just couldn't finish it. We couldn't finish it. And it was my mom's money, and she was going to go to the old folks home, so we just let it go. And people don't realize that the recession started in 2005. You remember all the REOs who started to hit the streets in 2005, and by 2006, there was a ton. You remember those? Or maybe weren't in the business then.
I don't. I got in 2005, and I definitely didn't have the context to understand, you know, what was normal and what wasn't at that point.
Well, we went from a $100,000 home to a $75,000 home between 2005 and 2006, and we put $30,000 into it. You know, that was one of them. We put $50,000 into another one, and it went to hell. So. But I didn't feel so bad because South Boulder, you know, the Republic of Boulder here next to Denver, so, you know, it was a kind of a fixed neighborhood, and it was just going nothing but up. It went down 22% in 2005. 22%. Wow. So that's what I'm saying. The little guy can get eaten by dips. Like, what if you bought a house, you know, like in January? We're trying to flip it in February or March. Mm-hmm. What would have happened to you?
For me?
Now you're saying that, you know, things went pretty hot. That's good to know. I'm hoping that those guys were able to recover in March, April, and May.
we had 18 projects at the time when COVID shut down.
And we had what?
18 projects.
18. So good for you.
18. Yeah. You know, in various stages of you know, development or sale, but there was a four week period where it got a little hairy, where, you know, we didn't really know what was going to happen, and then in hindsight, looking back at it, you know, that's when the buyers really started to come out. They were sick of their houses, I think, and they didn't have anything better to do other than to shop for real estate. So. So, you know, we started seeing a lot more activity. So there was probably four or five houses that we still sold where we thought we were going to sell them at, but we weren't seeing, they weren't moving as fast as they were before.
But cut it down so you can move it through.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we didn't actually, surprisingly, we didn't have to cut prices. Just some of them just sat there.
That's good. Tarak, it looks like you want to jump in here. Am I pronouncing your name right?
Yes, you are. Yes. Property is the oldest business going.
Real estate?
Yeah, real estate. We call
absolutely.
It property, you know, and there's
plenty. It came before even prostitution.
Yeah, not to leave.
I don't know about that, but I'm sure they were selling properties just about as fast as they were hooking in the streets. So,
true. I hope the other people who are still on are enjoying our conversation. And if you guys feel like jumping in, please do. You know, we can move on to another topic if you like. One thing that everybody has in common is entrepreneurship. So if you want to say anything, if you come across something interesting about entrepreneurship, about startups, please feel free to share. And by the way, I'm the startup manager for London and the United Kingdom. Okay, I've been with this organization now for nearly 7 months. And my background is in the entertainment industry. So Kelly, Oliver, I know Oliver. Oliver is the chief financial officer for the organization.
Hello, Oliver. Well, Hi, you know, Oliver. People don't realize just what a business that entertainment is. You know, you want to make a movie. It's like one of the tougher startups to go sell, right?
Exactly.
I mean,
exactly.
You know, if you got a widget, you can touch and feel it, you know, and you can say, hey, we can make a bunch of these and make some money. But you say, want to make a movie, there are so many variables in a movie. There's so many variables in putting a show together. There's so many variables in
Thing is, with movies
having to do
now,
in the arts.
With movies, now anybody with a couple of $1,000 in their pockets can make a feature film.
The hard part
is getting eyeballs.
Selling it.
Selling it. That's the hard part, and that's where crowdfunding comes in.
Distribution.
Or sourcing your audience.
You know? Speaking of crowdfunding, while we're on the subject, Brian, have you thought of a crowdfunding model for your business?
Discussed it. For us, it just didn't seem right. We weren't doing a large raise. We're not set up on logistically, from my understanding on what it would take to manage that, smaller investors.
That's true. You get a ton of investors. You're going to have an automated model to do that.
Yeah.
So same for a movie. Anytime you do crowdfunding for, $1,000, $10,000, it has to be a certain percentage of the non-accredited investor's income that you're going to wind up with some overhead, these 1% people are going to be, they think that they own a big part of the company. So they're going to just, if they want to whine, they're going to whine loud. And if they can't whine to you, they're going to go to somebody else and, try to whine to, and you don't want them bothering your investors. So you're right. You really need to be prepared with that machine to do a crowdfunding.
Yeah.
So anyway, Tarak, I interrupted you about your movie.
Yeah, it takes time. You've got to have about 2 months preparation. You've got to line up the people who are going to invest the first couple of thousand.
Right.
And then you actually launch. And if you go on Indiegogo, you get the money that you raise. But the fees are higher from Indiegogo. With Kickstarter, if you don't hit your target, you don't get any money.
Right. Is that a requirement or a statement that you make up front?
No, that's a requirement.
That's a requirement. You have to make your goal. Yeah.
Yeah. With Kickstarter, you have to make your goal. With Indiegogo, you get whatever money people pledge.
Oh, okay. But, Indiegogo is different than Kickstarter. I got it.
It's different. But
the
fees that Indiegogo charges are higher. So you've got to build those fees into your budget.
Exactly. Yeah. It's. Well, of course, you should have that line item in your budget always for
financing
somebody who's going to help you raise.
Yeah, financing costs, which I find.
Yeah, your financing costs, right. Yeah.
A lot of the startups don't have that.
Now, if I understand correctly, and I always ask anybody from a country that I don't know exactly, but, for anybody to be an intermediary for an investment raise in the U.S., it's an absolute no-no. Unless they're licensed, you got to be licensed. And if they try to say, well, we'll make you a consultant and, pay you as a consultant and all of that happy stuff, they'll pierce that veil so fast if there's a problem.
In the United Kingdom, as far as I know, with fundraising, you don't have to follow that.
You don't. Okay. That's good.
Unless I think you're raising more than $1 million.
If you're raising more, you get into a new horizon.
Exactly.
An event horizon, so to speak. Yeah. So for under a million, it's not as critical as over a million.
And then you have these special schemes called Small Enterprise Investment Scheme, where you get your profits deferred. If you keep the money in for 3 years, then there's the Enterprise Investment Scheme, where you can raise up to a million.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, scheme in British is not like in the US. When we talk about scheme, that's usually
a derogatory term.
Shaky. Yeah, scheme is, so when you talk to Americans, don't use the word scheme.
All right, okay. A plan.
Yeah, it's a plan. It's a plan, it's a program, the government authorized plan of some kind. But scheme, right, Brian? I said, I got this scheme for you. What are you going to immediately say? Boom. Bye-bye.
Listen, I've got to go. I've got another meeting to attend to. Okay, so it's been lovely talking with you. Yeah. As soon as the event is live, I will drop you an email.
Yeah, let Brian know too, right?
Yeah, if you're interested, Brian, it's a cash prize.
Yeah. Oh, now, okay. One thing I want to encourage you to tell all of your entrepreneur friends, if you're not in at least 5 boards of other entrepreneurs, you're being very selfish and very stupid, because that is such a great way to learn and to help each other. Okay. So you're missing the learning process to see how everybody else is being successful and making mistakes, and you're also not contributing to the rest of the entrepreneur world. So get on the advisory boards of at least 4 other outfits, maybe 5. Okay.
That's some good advice there.
Yeah. Yeah. It really helps.
I'm on the board of 2 or 3 at the moment.
Good job. Good job. And really, you just tell them, I'll give you 2 hours a month, you know. I don't want to go to any meetings. Just call me if you got a problem or an idea. See, that's the way to do it. The trouble is that people think, oh, boards, oh, God, that's those meetings and they go on forever and there's some jerk who wants to, you know, dominate the whole thing. No, you just say, I'll be at your board of advisors, but you call me when you want to know something. Works very well. And you also establish a billing rate. If you need more than a couple hours, I turn the meter on. Yeah. All right, my friend. Nice to meet you. Bye-bye.
So, Brian, I got to actually go to Kenton. I'll email you. Thank you so much. Good advice.
Good to meet you, Brian. And I'll look for your info.
Very cool. All right, bye.
Good deal. So, Kelly, are you still kicking? Natalia. Hey, John, you asked some great questions. You still around? All right. Well, looks like everybody's, just off doing something else. So I've got people blasting me away on on WhatsApp. So I'm going to go talk to them. Enjoy. Have a great 4th of July, too. Bye-bye. Wait a second, I'm going to check my chat before I go. Nope, nothing new. All right. Bye-bye.